I wanted to talk about this prayer because I need some feedback from you, because I think when I started to look at this, everything or lots of things seemed to fit into place, but I think I might have got carried away, so I'm not sure whether I've tried to fit square pegs into round holes. So I'm hoping that when I've explained what I'm trying to understand about the prayer, you will at least think about it, and maybe sometime in the future we can come back and discuss it again. Right. Now, this started off 4 or 5 years ago, because once I'd retired from work, I started to go to quite a lot of funerals, and almost at every funeral we said the Lord's Prayer. And of course, people get into the habit of saying the Lord's Prayer without even thinking about it. It just becomes a habit of just repeating it. People most likely learn it when they're children. They learn it off by heart, so they remember everything that there is to say. Now, my attitude is that there is a lot of power in a prayer. And I think if people understood the prayer better, then more energy would be put into the power behind the prayer. So what I'm going to try to do is explain the prayer as I've been studying it over the last 3 or 4 years. First of all, however the prayer is said, even if you don't understand it, I think there is power behind the prayer. But I think if you really understand it, then I think more energy is behind the power. And when you consider the number of people throughout the world who are saying this prayer regularly, I think a lot of power could be put into the sort of atmosphere of the world if they understood what the prayer meant. So, the first thing I want to do, I want to tell you, or read to you, what comes before the prayer in St. Matthew. The prayer is mentioned in both St. Matthew and in St. Luke. That's the two occasions where this prayer is mentioned. Where it's mentioned in Luke, it's a bit vague, but this is the version which is mentioned in Luke. And this is what he says. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not the repetition of the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. After the manner, therefore, pray ye, and goes on to the prayer. Now, the first part of the prayer talks about our Father in heaven. So, from the theosophical point of view, we have to try to imagine what is meant by our Father. And if we look at the general threefold constitution, which is generally used in society today, of the spirit, the soul, and the body, what you hear is at any sort of baptism or when someone dies and they mention the sign of the cross, they always say, in the name of the Father and of the Son, and the words of the Bible say, and of the Holy Ghost. But obviously, when we think of the Holy Ghost, we are thinking of Spirit. So if we have Spirit of the Holy Ghost, then I have assumed that that soul and that body must be in relation to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. So we have the Holy Ghost, the Father, and the Son. So if that's the case, if we now look at it from the theosophical point of view, we can relate Spirit to the Spirit up here. We can relate body down to this part of our being. But then we come to soul, we have this upper and lower mind. So from a theosophical point of view, when we talk about the Father in heaven, I have put the higher mind as the Father in heaven and the lower mind as the body. So if we think now, our Father which art in heaven, we are talking about our spirit, or at least our higher self. We're not going to go any higher than that. Oh, we're not going to this because this is beyond us really. We know that when we pass away, our higher self goes into Devachan, and relating Devachan to heaven, that is how I think we can look at our Father which is in heaven. Hallowed be thy name is fairly straightforward, because hallowed means sacred, and we would consider our higher self to be sacred. When we come to thy kingdom come, we are taught that when we are in Devachan, that part of our body, because obviously to exist in any certain condition, we must have a body. So that body is in heaven, as we say in the prayer. So when we say, thy kingdom come, we want, or we're trying to ask our higher self that our lower self also can experience this feeling of being in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread is fairly straightforward. If we say this prayer, as most people do, either in the morning or afternoon or evening, then the day will start from when they say the prayer. I mean, I say the prayer in the mornings because that's when I do my meditation. This part of forgive us our trespasses, that's the part I had most problems with, because that part didn't seem to fit in to our teachings on karma. Because I don't think that we are in a position to forgive other people what they do. So in order to understand it, I have suggested that sometimes we offend people when we don't realize that we're offending people. And if that is the case, then it's up to those people to allow us to have this attitude where we won't be blamed for trespassing or offending them, because our intention is not to offend. So I can understand this only in that situation where we unfortunately might offend someone without realizing it. When it says, lead us not into temptation, that again I think is a difficult part to understand, because we don't expect our higher self to lead us into temptation. So as far as I can see is that when we're not thinking of our higher self, we obviously might fall into a situation where we could end up in trouble, and this is where we want protection from our higher self in order to protect us if we might be being led into temptation. Deliver us from evil is a fairly straightforward one. And when we come to, for thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, then obviously we are thinking of the condition of the higher self in heaven in Devachan. We say forever and ever because really there is no end to life, and however we progress, then we hope that that improvement that we will get from being in heaven will lead us further and might improve our condition wherever to wherever we arrive. So the Amen is the same as we hear when we hear the Buddha say Aum, or when you have the sign in theosophical literature of A-U-M. It is a command really that all this that has been said beforehand be brought into existence, and the rest of the prayer then will be made real for the person who is saying it. So if we can understand that in the terms of the Sevenfold Constitution, then I think that prayer will be a much more powerful thing that we can say if we can look at it in this light. So basically that is all I want to say about the prayer, but what I'd like you to do is to think about it, discuss it with other people if you wish, see what they think, and then perhaps maybe we can come back later in the year and discuss it. As I say, when I first started to investigate this, I got carried away, and these are the conclusions that I've come to. Now,